Thanks, Dr. Lena. I appreciate that. Delighted to be up on the mothership. It's always good to be in Fort Worth. When I first got down to Houston to meet the dean and to see the campus and everything, our dean, Dr. Autry, you probably all know, said to me, well, you've been to the aircraft carrier. Welcome to the dinghy. You're quite smaller, quite a lot smaller. But it's always good to be with you all. Let me introduce to you our speaker for today, Dr. Chris Armstrong. Chris Armstrong holds his PhD from Duke in American Religious History. He was a Christian history professor at Bethel Seminary for a decade. He is the editor of Christian History Magazine, which many of you are probably avid readers of. If you're not, you can go to christianhistorymagazine.org and you can access issues on that website. He's also the founding editor of the Pathios blog on faith and work. He's the founding director of Wheaton College's Institute on Faith and Vocation, which is called OPUS. He's been doing that for 2 years. And he has two books out that you'll want to get your hands on. Patron Saints for Postmoderns, which is published by InterVarsity Press, and Medieval Wisdom for Modern Christians, which is forthcoming in about a month from Baker / Brazos. And you'll want to definitely read that. So please welcome our speaker, Dr. Chris Armstrong.
Introduction, Dr. Wilsey, and looking forward to sharing with you a little bit this morning. I'll probably wander around a bit. I don't like being confined behind a podium. These things are pretty cool that way. As long as it doesn't shut off halfway through, and then we'll just have a shorter talk. Talking about flourishing in Christian historical perspective this morning, human flourishing. And flourishing is kind of it's a bit of a weasel word or sort of a loose word, a jello word. It can mean a lot of different things. But in the conversation that's going on and it's increasing right now, generally we talk about happiness, well-being, individual dimensions, social dimensions, physical, and spiritual dimensions as well. But we're talking about what the Greek philosophers were talking about when they talked about what it is that conduces to human happiness in the tradition known as the eudaimonist tradition. And it's been going on ever since. There is, as we'll see, a Christian tradition of eudaimonism as well, in which great thinkers like Augustine and Aquinas interacted with Aristotle and these other thinkers and brought it into a Christian key, of course, bringing the gospel to bear on the question of what it means to be happy as a human. I'm going to move quickly, initially, past the story of spiritual flourishing, and I'm going to look at some material, physical, and social dimensions of flourishing as they've been supported and manifested in Christian history. Life in the body, we might call it, both life in the individual body and life in the social body. In the history of the church, it was the 5th century theologian Augustine who, following scripture, defined spiritual flourishing as being all about love. That is, both how we love God and how we experience his love in return. That set the tone for the way Christians have talked about happiness ever since. Though his whole theology was centered on love and spiritual flourishing, Augustine did leave a small door open for the physical or material dimension of flourishing. And later on in the 13th century, Thomas Aquinas opened it farther. But I think what's even more interesting than that is that how the church in different ways affirmed the body all along, both the individual material body and the social body, long before Aquinas came on the scene. When we turn from these great thinkers to the actual practice of the early church, we find something very interesting. Against pretty much every stereotype, the early Christians in fact affirmed the importance of the bodily life more than did the pagans. Early Christians regarded physical life as a gift of God that was so precious that they viewed the care of the sick as pretty much a categorical imperative, to use an anachronistic term. The gospel as proclaimed in the early centuries of Christianity did not limit itself to the salvation of souls for eternity, but was also directed at salvation and wholeness within this world. The care of the destitute generally, and particularly of the sick, became a duty incumbent on all believers. Now, this concern for physical healing emerged out of a larger and characteristically Judeo-Christian concern for the poor. Christian medical philanthropy and the emerging Christian institution of the hospital, which we sometimes forget today, was indeed a Christian institution in its origins, always centered around caring for the poor, especially those vulnerable to the misery and death brought on by illness. Church leaders encouraged all Christians to visit the sick, to help the poor, and each congregation also established and organized a mission or ministry of mercy, which would later be evolved intellectually in something called the tradition of the seven corporal works of mercy, which is based on Matthew 25. So if you think about the story of the sheep and the goats, giving water to the thirsty, dressing the naked, visiting the imprisoned, and so forth. They added to that out of the Apocrypha, burying the dead is the seventh of the works. The contrast couldn't have been more extreme. The Roman gods and Roman culture simply did not encourage a felt responsibility to assist the destitute, sick, or dying. Children and newborns were abandoned and exposed, and the elderly were sent to die in the streets. There was no social safety net. The chronically ill could be seen everywhere, streets, baths, forums, and many of them were homeless and Unlike this pagan culture, medical philanthropy could find its basis within the Christian movement in the biblical concept of the Imago Dei, God's creation of human beings in his image. And that implied that human life is precious and must be protected, even human physical life. This emphasis was in turn intensified and deepened by the New Testament doctrine of the Incarnation, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, John 1:14a. Early Christians believed that the motivation for charity should be God's self-giving love, his agape love to us, which reflected his nature. God loved the human race so much that he sent Christ in human flesh to die on the cross for our sins. Christians responded by demonstrating Christ's love to their brothers and sisters, who also bore God's image. The weaker and the more helpless the neighbor, the greater the need to show them the compassion of Christ. Hence, early Christians showed special concern for the protection of unborn and newborn life. Now, this sort of practical morality, so radically different from the social ethics of classical paganism, laid the foundation for Christian philanthropy and, again, the development of the hospital. It shouldn't surprise us, then, that as Rodney Stark argues, these novel healing practices and this novel belief in the value and dignity of the embodied human person became a determining factor in Christianity's early spread in the Roman Empire. In a pagan world entirely lacking in social services, Christians were their brother's keepers. The willingness of Christians to care for others was put on dramatic public display during a number of early plagues that swept through the Roman Empire. In fact, one of them happened in the early 250s during one of the major periods of persecution of the Christian church. Nonetheless, during that time, Christians went and they helped their neighbors, pagan and Christian. They went and they exposed themselves to that pestilence at the same time that many of the pagans were just heading for the hills, and sometimes even pitching the still living into essentially the gutters and saying, you know, just get away from me, I don't want to get sick. Of course, not every Christian was probably on the good side of this equation. Not every pagan was on the bad side of the equation. We're human beings. But the physical result of Christian succor of their neighbors during these times of plague and pestilence were very dramatic. We now know that elementary nursing, just providing food and water to someone who's suffering in a plague or in a pestilence, would reduce mortality by as much as 2/3. Just food and water, just caring for somebody in that easy way without any drugs or medicine or doctors. Consequently, Christians were more likely than pagans to recover, a visible benefit. Christian social services also were visible and valuable during the frequent natural and social disasters afflicting the Greco-Roman world: earthquakes, floods, famines, riots, civil wars, and invasions. The benefit of early Christians in this realm of physical flourishing were also not limited to times of emergency. Another example of early Christian action to promote human flourishing in this way, very physical way, was its treatment of women. There were an estimated 131 men for every 100 women in Rome during the period of the early church. You know why? Female babies were regularly either aborted or exposed. The disparity was even greater, I'm sorry, not aborted, but exposed after they were, the infanticide was practiced. Obviously, the Christian community did not practice this, and therefore did draw to itself women. Also within the Christian community, women enjoyed higher status and security than they did among their pagan neighbors. Pagan women typically were married at a very young age, often younger than puberty, to men much older than themselves. But Christian women were typically older and had more choice in who and if they married. In addition, Christian men and women as well were subject to strongly enforced rules against extramarital sex, and they could not easily divorce their wives, which happened quite often in the pagan world and most often led to the woman becoming destitute. All of this represented an early Christian contribution, again, to bodily material flourishing of human beings. Beyond the more basic kinds of physical flourishing we've been considering, as Christianity grew in size and influence into the medieval period, it also engaged more and more in a multiplicity of positive social and cultural spheres. In most of the modern Protestant literature on questions of flourishing, work, and vocation, the medieval period is treated presumptively as a benighted thousand-year interlude characterized by the complete dismissal of bodily work, for example, and indeed life in the body as spiritually second class. This is in fact so oversimplified as to be simply untrue. Just because the word, for example, vocation in this period becomes, as it does, reserved for priests, monks, and nuns, doesn't mean at all that we have here a sort of Gnostic turning against the bodily and the working life. Let's look briefly at the evidence of the period that, at its peak between 1000 and 1300 AD, embraced almost everything in culture and human life within the purview of the Christian faith. This path was started at the intersection of the late ancient and medieval periods in what Robert Marcus calls the desecularization of the world, or the sacralization of the world, and what Robert Louis Wilkin calls the Christianization of Hellenism, right around the 400s, 500s. Through the seminal centuries of the medieval period, as the church took over responsibility for public welfare, it became truly the custodian of whole swaths of Western society. Basil the Great's proto-hospital, Pope Gregory the Great's compassionate social action in 6th century Rome, when the aristocrats abandoned the city in the face of barbarian incursion, those were signs and forerunners of a larger reality. Church buildings grew increasingly more capacious, holidays were Christianized, monasteries became centers of social service, again, against sort of stereotypes. A lot of us, if we think about monasteries, particularly in that period, thought of people escaping from life and just becoming fairly useless, just sitting around in cells. But in fact, if you were sick at that for much of the entire thousand years of the medieval period, you would go to, initially at least, the monastery, where there were brothers who would feed you, who would house you, who would use basic herbal skills or surgical skills on your behalf. The 6th century Pope Gregory I, who I just mentioned, is worth a moment more. He's responsible for a key conceptual shift in early medieval thought. While Augustine, as I said, kind of cracked the door open a little bit for the physical, he really kind of held the active life, the life of action in the world of human society, in some suspicion, elevating instead the contemplative life of devotion to God. Gregory, however, came to see everyday work on behalf of one's neighbor as a spiritually essential activity. The active life was needed by the contemplative life. He said, I know some people who are doing, you know, the equivalent of janitorial work, who are more holy than some monks. Because when you get out into the world and you confront the sinfulness of the world, the brokenness, and really of your own self, it brings you back into prayer, and it brings you a deeper experience of contemplation, which again prepares you to go out into the active life in this sort of symbiotic and synergistic cyclical relationship. Mary needs Martha, Martha needs Mary. This actually sparked a sacramental, spiritual elevation of material activity. Even though it receded at times, that was always a kind of in the background of the medieval period. After Gregory's day, there was an interlude, sometimes known in the literature as the Dark Ages, in which the church really failed to create much positive in the cultural realm. Western society turned agrarian, incapable of supporting cultural development, and it really took the reurbanization of the West around 1000 AD, and the consequent rise of culture-making institutions such as the university, which flourished soon after 1000. To move the melding of spiritual and material flourishing theorized by Gregory the Great to the next level. Now, the 12th and 13th century witnessed both the, the real dominance of university and scholastic theology, as well as the Christian recovery and absorption, and very importantly, of Aristotle's long-lost scientific works by people such as Aquinas and his proto-empiricist mentor, Albertus Magnus. This recovery set the table not just for a regrowth of theology as the queen of the sciences, but also for the rise of the natural sciences themselves to new heights that hadn't been seen since the classical period. That story is told in fine essays by the eminent historian of science, David Lindberg, who's a Christian man. He teaches at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and he's the editor of the Cambridge History of Science. He knows that story very well and tells it well. And another book-length treatment by a scholar named James Hannah called The Genesis of Science, How the Christian Middle Ages Launched the Scientific Revolution. Again, that's a breaker of stereotypes, right? We think of the whole medieval period as kind of a period of darkness. That's not actually the case. The long-term impact of this development on human flourishing was obviously staggering. I'm talking about the rise of science. It does start in the 12th, 13th century. There's something called the 12th century Renaissance. It really comes finally to full flourishing in the 16th and 17th, especially the 17th century in the Scientific Revolution. But if you want to track the impact that has, I mean, I think we're all aware of it on some level, what science and technology has done for us as human beings in terms of our health, our wealth, our ability to live in better ways. But if you look at for example, economic statisticians who lay this out, there's this sort of this long line along a graph from the beginning of recorded time until about 1800, which represents sort of almost equal level of health and wealth and flourishing. And then in around 1800, once you have the technologies and new ways of meeting human needs that start with the Scientific Revolution coming into sort of full effect with a new commercial society, you have this hockey stick effect that just sort of shoots up. If you haven't seen the YouTube video by economic statistician Hans Rosling called 200 Countries, 200 Years, 4 Minutes, it's really well worth watching. It's quite stunning. Despite the still too common but entirely mistaken narrative of the supposed warfare between science and theology, of course there have been skirmishes along the way, starting in the high medieval period, the church in fact created the conditions for growth in scientific and technological knowledge, and the tremendous modern uptake in human material flourishing that arose from that growth really stems from this activity, from essentially, going all the way back to Aquinas, a Christian reclamation of the science that they discovered in the writings of Aristotle. And though we don't have time to go through it now, we should also note that in the same period we saw a new thriving of the arts, as preserved, for example, in the soaring cathedrals and stunning sculptural art of the Gothic period. We might call it a flourishing of beauty, which is a very important sort of flourishing as well. Meanwhile, elaborated by Thomas Aquinas, the tradition of the seven corporal works of mercy, and also at the same time the corresponding spiritual works, continued to feed and expand the Christian tradition of medical philanthropy. In the 13th century and beyond, this created a new tradition that elevated compassionate works to near salvific dimensions. To work in or donate to the hospitals that were proliferating across Western Europe, thus providing for the bodily health of others, and especially of the poor, was to enact the compassion of Christ himself for us, and thus to come closer to heaven. Finally, in the late medieval period, the 14th and 15th centuries, we saw lay people reclaiming ordinary work and material flourishing as vocational in God. Teachers like Tauler and Eckhart and groups like the Brethren of the Common Life set the table for Luther's doctrine of vocation in the priesthood of all believers. There's a whole lot to say about Luther on this. We don't have time now, but to summarize really briefly, Luther saw work and vocations as the way that God provides for our bodily and our social needs, kind of common grace. God placed each person in a station, butcher, baker, magistrate, pastor, candlestick maker. Through each person's vocations, God worked as if behind a mask, not through spectacular miracles or extraordinary acts, but through our everyday work. In elaborating that, however, the great reformer separated material from spiritual flourishing. Though our work gains great dignity from its association with God's providential activity, it has nothing to do with our salvation. or our eventual union with God in heaven. So Luther, in a sense, reverses Aquinas' worldly theology and even shuts the door that Augustine had opened to consider bodily flourishing as an actual component of spiritual flourishing, a more holistic view. Although for Luther, vocation is a gospel thing with gospel dignity, because through it we serve our neighbor, nonetheless only faith through God's grace serves God himself. This breaks apart something of the religious holism of Matthew 25 and the seven corporal acts of mercy, which had tied together spiritual and material flourishing, love for God and love for neighbor throughout the medieval period. As you do these things to the least of these, you do them as well for me, Christ had said. Luther felt this break was necessary to claw back the pernicious works righteousness of some late medievals, and no doubt it was. But at the same time, he drove a wedge again through between the material and the spiritual dimensions of flourishing that would take centuries to dislodge. If you've read or looked at H. Richard Niebuhr's categories of Christ and culture, you'll remember that he identified the Lutheran position, or Luther's position, as a relationship of paradox between Christ and culture. That paradox was somewhat lessened in John Calvin and the Reformed Protestant movement that he helped to spark, which began to return Western Christianity to the culture-engaged, holistic, transformative force it had been at the height of the medieval period. Calvin affirmed, to some degree, Aquinas' connection, following Gregory, between the contemplative and active lives, the spiritual devotion to God, and the active blessing of the neighbor through work. For Calvin, as Lee Hardy puts it, the contemplative life is actually subordinated to the ends of the active life, and this fed an ethos of social action and indeed social reform that has deeply impacted Western Christianity ever since, especially in a stream going, taking place in Holland, in England, and in America. In Calvin, we have the affirmation that God wants to address, through the Christian's obedient actions in the world, human life in the social, not just the physical body, and all the dimensions of that relate, political, judicial, and so forth. Unlike Luther, who viewed human stations as fixed, also, and the social order is inviolable, Luther was, after all, a medieval man, a late one. Calvin laid the groundwork for an active reforming and transforming of social realities. Calvinists have typically insisted that not only people's personal individual lives, but also human society need to be reformed according to the word of God. Obviously, the city of Geneva was kind of the experiment that Calvin himself started with that. The social order must not be merely accepted without complaint, as if it was dropped down from heaven by God, but surveyed with the critical eye of an Old Testament prophet. This created the groundwork for the bloodless British Glorious Revolution of 1688, the American social and political experiment of the following century, and the Christian social reforming activities of people like Wilberforce in England, and of the multiplied social reformers of the American 19th century as well. The seeds of Calvin's more culture-positive Christianity bore fruit in other places. Such as in the neo-Calvinism of Abraham Kuyper and Herman Bavinck in the 19th, early 20th centuries, who elaborated from this Calvinist baseline a fully blown Christian social ethic. This more modern Calvinist ethic took Calvin's focus on the contribution of individual human gifts and freedoms to our social flourishing and extended it to every sphere of human life, from the family to the political order. And in doing so, it retained a vision of the freedom and dignity of individual humans made in the image of God, that imago Dei, which pressed back against the totalizing schemes of statists and other theorists who believed they could construct a new social order from the top down. In this, the neo-Calvinists shared what modern Catholics in the 19th and 20th century have termed the principle of subsidiarity. Humans should have the freedom to address their social problems and issues of need at the level at which they occur, not to be dictated to from some higher level, for example, by government strictures or regulations. Both traditions also affirm, both meaning this neo-Calvinist and the Catholic tradition, have also affirmed the right to private property while also encouraging private charity. But each also saw that the fallenness of human individuals also infected human institutions. So while we must proceed cautiously in light of our limited knowledge, there are times when we do need to step in and attempt to correct and transform institutions where we can. This is Niebuhr's category of Christ-transforming culture, not the paradox that we saw in the Lutheran view. Nonetheless, once the theological ducks of the Reformation had been sorted out and put in a row, even as early as Luther's right-hand man and interpreter, Melanchthon, and through the more culture-positive ministrations of the Reformed branch of Protestantism that we've been talking about, the stage was set for a renewal of Christian support of the sciences. And that renewal was, more often than not, accompanied by a pious and fervent attention to spiritual flourishing. I got a chance to do this when I came to Christian History Magazine, when it was at Christianity Today in the Chicagoland in 2002. The first issue I worked on was called The Christian Face of the Scientific Revolution. And it really opened my eyes to work on it. I kept thinking of perhaps Christian undergraduates working in the sciences who were struggling in their own hearts about whether there was something maybe intrinsically at war or at tension between Christianity and science properly done. And what I found out, looking at this roster of fathers of the scientific revolution, and there were very few mothers yet, although a few came later, there was again and again, these were committed Christians. These were people who, sometimes not entirely orthodox, Isaac Newton was kind of Unitarian wacko, and there was other stuff going on, but they were really committed to thinking the thoughts of God after him, and to exploring and unfolding the wonders and beauties and the kinds of usefulness that hadn't been discovered yet in the created world that came to them from God. They wanted to find new ways to love their neighbor through the blessings that new understandings of science and technology could bring. A great study, and we don't have time to go into it here, is the Royal Society in England in the 1600s and 1700s. It's full of all these Anglicans and Puritans who ordinarily wouldn't have even been sitting at the same table talking to each other, but had this common vision of human flourishing, excitement about the created world of God, and came together to explore so many seminal areas of science, what we would know as modern science. All Christian, all coming at it from a solid Christian theological view and an understanding that human flourishing matters to God. I want to take just a brief moment as we start to wind down here to look at one example that I happen to know fairly well because it's part of my doctoral study, and that is John Wesley and his Methodists, and look at how some of these themes of human flourishing worked out in his approach to the common good. In his Primer in the Acton series, David Wright says, "The central emphasis of the Wesley's ministry was the belief that people matter because they are created in the image of God." You hear that theme again? "Therefore, their life and ministry worked to restore the lives of people that had been damaged by the fall, and they did so by creating structures that would help disciple people and create healthy, flourishing communities." Wesley was even more alert to the common good than his Reformed forebears, and he was deeply influenced by Puritanism in particular. Famously so, in fact, that he did not believe that there could be anything such thing as a solitary Christian. You can't be a Christian alone. You're inherently in community. You're saved into community. You're saved into society, and that has to be part of your view and your understanding of what the Christian life is. So again, he forged these communal organizational forms from the beginning of his ministry that would give people accountability and help as they journeyed towards wholeness. They lifted people through education, not only in more classically theological matters, but also just in how to live well in all the dimensions of their lives. The early Methodists under Wesley provided secure relational anchors in a world in which the old social realities were being torn apart by just the very beginning of the Industrial Revolution that they were experiencing in the mid-1700s and late 1700s. These structures that Wesley created inculcated a new ethic of love and social responsibility. Holiness was not simply a matter of what went on inside your heart. It had to be externalized in service to others through works of mercy and even honest business practices like refusing to lend money at usurious rates or to borrow when you weren't sure you could pay back. Nor did Wesley inveigh against money or economic activity or prosperity by themselves. Although he was deeply concerned for the ways the love of money can become an idol for us, damaging our relationships with God and others. He said this in a sermon on the use of money, quote, "Wealth is an excellent gift of God that when well handled by Christians becomes food for the hungry, drink for the thirsty, clothing for the naked, rest for the traveler." You hear that language from Matthew 25 in that longstanding tradition. Support for the widow and the orphan, defense for the oppressed, health for the sick, and even life for the dying. In short, Wesley recognized the importance of that great human enterprise of creating economic value. This is no stretch for the movement that, as David Wright reminds us, transformed people's personal lives, helped to abolish slavery, reverse the spread of addiction, helped to humanize brutal industrial working conditions, encouraged the growth of a middle class, addressed inhumane prison practices, and helped to spread education for all. All while, of course, preaching the gospel and seeing people's lives transformed. In short, Wesley didn't abstract our spiritual lives from our material lives. He provided a pattern of this worldly asceticism, to use Weber's term, that doesn't apply just in our prayer closets or in the walls of our churches. He gave his people an ethic for a transformed life, an ethic of assurance, integrity, and authenticity that if we learn to live it in our work, will transform every aspect of that work too. I want to say a word more about sanctification or holiness, which was obviously a central Christian concept for Wesley. Holiness of heart and life. He used to call this having the mind of Christ and walking as he walked. I think we can all agree that's a pretty important value. He thought that was the epitome of Christianity. That was the house into which the porch of repentance and the door of justification by faith led. And he framed holiness in terms of love, in terms of the heart, the center of human motivation. He taught that holiness healed and redirected disordered tempers, or states of mind, even emotional states. In fact, he called sanctification perfect love. Holiness and wholeness were, for Wesley, two sides of the same coin. What Wesley worked for in teaching on holiness was not self-interest that you had to abrogate or desire that you had to cut off, but self-interest and desire that were transformed into a higher interest and a higher desire. An interest in and a love for God, of course, first and foremost, and then a love to others pouring out from that central love to and from God. This is very simply an Augustinian model. This is not an innovation. All the best stuff in church history just comes up again and again because it's scriptural. It comes from that central tradition. And Wesley did reflect that. In fact, when he was asked, what is the character of a Methodist? He said, a Methodist is someone who is happy all the time. And then he went on to describe a rich and joyful life which was grounded in the transformation of human desires and loves and motives, and into simply living well in lots of ways, both physical, social, and spiritual. Again, though, Wesley didn't just leave holiness in the realm of a personal, individual ethic. He turned it into these brilliant organizational forms, the societies, classes, the bands, the annual conferences. And his impact, and a whole section of the paper I can't read here for lack of time, but you look at how the early Methodists lived, both economically and socially, and it was suffused with this sense of the importance of human bodily and social life as well as the importance of spiritual life. There were many mine bosses in Cornwall, England, for instance, who were Christians, who were lay preachers, in fact, when they weren't doing their business dealings. And they were different as bosses than the non-Christian bosses. They ran their operations in a different way, and in a way that was more conducive to human flourishing. All right, we're going to wrap up. I'm going to, in conclusion, since we've done this kind of brief historical survey, kind of take a quick look at where we are today. And I'm going to do that through the lens of the Yale theologian Miroslav Volf. He has a new book out. It's a very striking book. It's called simply Flourishing. And he argues that there are two ways of living today that are swallowing up human flourishing all over the world. The first of these is the way that Nietzsche imputed to all world religions, which trades ordinary pleasures and flourishing for a hard and fast structure of meaning embedded in a theistic understanding of the world. In short, Nietzsche said that religion, Nietzsche, no friend of religion, right, says that while it gives people the meaning that they crave, it goes around, quote, squelching life's energies and killing ordinary joys. The second way of being, which also is a threat to flourishing, is the opposite of the first. It gives up all grounds for meaning in order to gain maximum pleasure. The technical term for this is actually nihilism, and it has two forms. The soft form, Nietzsche described, is belonging to, quote, the last men of a decadent Western civilization, who are weary of all striving and obsessed with comfort and safety, dreaming petty dreams and enjoying unsubtle pleasures, entertaining ourselves to idiocy while imagining ourselves as the measure of humanity. To update the observation, this is the sort of meaningless hedonism that, for example, Neil Postman talked about in his book, Amusing Ourselves to Death, wonderful title. Sometimes I worry that my kids are amusing themselves to death. I want to pull them out of those screens for a few minutes. Or the Hollywood portrayal through in the movie WALL-E, when those post-apocalyptic humans are floating through space in the corporate starliner, each in their own little pod. Remember this image? Bloated and passive, fixed on the glowing screen with a giant high fructose drink at their sides. There are no values and there's no flourishing there, because meaning is no longer important. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. The second and harder form of this pleasure-focused nihilism, says Wolf, is the creed of the ruthless high achievers and the connoisseurs of what are deemed to be the very best things in life, or anyone who's trying to climb that ladder. This second kind believes that since there is no God who makes the world meaningful, the only values in the world are the values that we humans assign to things. The problem here, of course, is that when all meaning originates with us, we have no good reason to choose one thing over another, or one way of life over another, except our own preference itself. This is a quote from Wolf: "Nothing has authority of us or any power to move us, and then because what we freely give, we can equally freely take back." Neither of these kinds of nihilism, the passive entertaining ourselves to death or the active world-conquering nihilism, is a sustainable source of human flourishing. But neither is the kind of fundamentalist, and I use that in the broadest sense, religious life, that squelches all pleasures in order to gain meaning. In fact, says Wolf, to choose between meaning and pleasure is always to make the wrong choice. Pleasure without meaning is vapid. Meaning without pleasure is crushing. However, at the end of the book, Wolf comes to his central argument. The truth is, he says, we do not need to choose between these two. The unity of meaning and pleasure, which we experience as joy, is given with the God who is love. This, at last, is why Wolf believes that we need religion in a globalized world, which is the argument of that book. Why and how does this alchemy of meaning and pleasure take place? Wolf sketches a Christian answer which, unsurprisingly, draws directly from early and medieval traditions of love that I mentioned at the beginning of this talk, formulated by thinkers like Augustine and Aquinas. This meaning plus pleasure proposition, which is at the heart of Christian flourishing, comes to us when we go to God for both spiritual and physical and social flourishing. Many people, even many Christians, don't really believe this both-and proposition exists for us. Wolf puts it like this: relationship to God belongs to the very makeup of human beings. Whether we're aware of it or not, in all of our longings, in one way or another, we're also longing for God. Our lives are oriented toward the infinite God, and they find meaning in relation to the God who created the world and will bring it to consummation. Apart from God, with the earth of our existence unchained from its sun, the deeper meaning of our lives, the kind that doesn't subvert itself by its arbitrariness, eludes us. Parched for meaning, what do? We then project the power to give meaning onto the finite goods that surround us, the muscle tone of our bodies, or sex, or money, or success in work, or fame, or family, or nation. But each of these turns out to be unfulfilling. This is just straight up Augustine. But the caricature of faith, often promulgated not just outside, but inside its communities, is that the meaning God gives us also must take away ordinary pleasure, ordinary kinds of flourishing. When we embrace God, don't we drop from our hold, says Wolf, and ourselves as beings, when we embrace God, don't we drop from our hold the world and ourselves as beings whose senses are alive to the sounds and smells and textures and tastes of the world? To this caricature, Wolf responds with a simple list of central Christian doctrines. If God created the material world that is inhabited by sentient beings, became flesh in the person of Jesus of Nazareth, if the bodies of those bound to God in faith and love are temples of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians 6:19, then the opposition between attachment to God and the enjoyment of the ordinary things of life must be false. Not only is there no real opposition here, but in fact, Wolf argues, attachment to God amplifies and deepens enjoyment of the world. As C.S. Lewis put the same point over a half century ago, we Christians can say that because we love something else more than this world, that is God, we love even this world better than those who know no other. We love this world better, and we can enjoy it better too. We can flourish both materially and spiritually. This, I would argue, is the most legitimately and traditionally Christian way to think about flourishing. an experience that weaves together both the love and enjoyment of God and each other, with the albeit subordinate, but nonetheless real and even sustaining, love and enjoyment of the world. Not every part of our tradition supports this hybrid form of flourishing, but many do, including those emanating from such speakers as Augustine and Aquinas and Jonathan Edwards and C.S. Lewis and others. These, again, are the Christian eudaimonists who reconcile the world-transcending and the world-enjoying facets of our faith through a narrative of love and desire. God's for us, ours for him, and through those primary loves, also ours for each other and for the world itself. If we're to think constructively about flourishing as involving not just the surpassing spiritual enjoyment of relationship with God, but also, again, life in the body, both our material and our social body, then we must understand our faith as an incarnational and even sacramental one. Our faith is one in which every experience of the material and social worlds is colored and framed by the love of God. Our faith involves, as Wolf says, a giver, God, a recipient, you, and a gift, the world. So if you love the Lord your God with all your heart, and all your soul, and all your strength, and all your mind, and also in response to God's word and his love, you also love your neighbor as yourself, and if you imagine that your neighbors do the same, however imperfectly and humbly, which is the Christian vision of the social life, then how can you not flourish? Then, as Wolf concludes, each thing in the world is now a relationship marked by love. Each distant star and gentle touch, each face and every whiff of the freshly plowed earth, in sum, literally every good and beautiful thing, shimmers with an aura both vibrantly real and undetectable to our five senses. Each thing in the world is more than itself, and just so a source of deep and many-layered pleasure. As a church historian, I want to assure you of this. Again, this vision of human flourishing is not a novelty concocted by a modern theologian from Yale. It is the main line of the Christian tradition, at least through the end of the medieval era. Lewis, in describing this, Lewis, in describing the sacramental understanding of the world in his book, The Discarded Image, painted a picture of a medieval person standing and looking up into the night sky. This is Lewis. You must conceive yourself looking up at the night, looking up at a world lighted, warmed, and resonant with music. This is how the medievals saw their universe, as a place where each sphere is a conscious and intellectual being moved by an intellectual love of God. The medieval universe was tingling with anthropomorphic life, dancing, ceremonial, a festival, and not a machine. The great medieval poet Dante expressed this theoscientific vision of the medieval synthesis through his Commedia, which culminates at the end of the Paradiso with the pilgrim Dante seeing a vision of the universe as animated by a perfectly rational, perfectly loving being. The verses wrap up this imaginative and rational togetherness, this unity. This is Dante. My mind was struck by lightning, through which my longing was at last fulfilled. Here powers failed my high imagination, but by now, desire and will, my desire and my will returned like a balanced wheel rotated evenly by the love that moves the sun and the other stars. If we truly viewed the world in the way that Wolf or the medievals did, as animated in every respect, physical as well as spiritual, by a loving God who desires both that we enjoy him and that we enjoy the world, then we would be more able to bring together those two kinds of flourishing, the spiritual, physical and social, against the two kinds of nihilism that even now threaten to kill, steal, and destroy the abundant life